robot makers, how safe is the code on your MicroPython device? If you connect it to Wi-Fi, how do you protect the username and password that are stored on this device? Because anyone who has access to this device and can plug it into their computer can read your code and steal your secrets. Let's find out. So MicroPython is an interpreted language. This means it's plain text stored on your device. So this is a security challenge. Anyone can read them files if they have access to the device. How do we securely store usernames and passwords? And how about other secrets such as IP addresses of servers that we might need to access? What is the problem? Why is this an issue? So the device is standalone. Any files it needs to encode or encrypt require a key. But that key also needs to be held on the device as well. So that means that we need a key that must be stored in plain text, and that also means that an attacker can read that key to unlock our secrets. And this is a catch-22. So the real solution is to have a secure enclave or a crypto chip. Now the Arduino Nano RP2040 Connect has one of these chips, however this is not exposed to MicroPython yet. This is how details are stored on your iPhone and other mobile devices securely, meaning if an attacker gets hold of your device, they can't retrieve that username and password or any other secrets from your device, not even the FBI. So what about the Pico, Microbit and other boards? Most Microbit devices that are out there today are designed for simplicity, ease of use and educational development. These devices store the source code in plain text on the device, making it easy to update and maintain, however it's also wide open to anybody else that wants to read your security details. So one way that we can protect our devices is something that's called security through obscurity. It's not really secure, but it can lower the risk to the casual thief. You can frustrate attempts to gain access to your secure keys by using special functions and using pre-encoded usernames and passwords. The device can decode these without the attacker easily understanding them. We can also compile MicroPython code into an MPY file, which is a binary format. If you open an MPY file, you'll see a mixture of bytecode and plain text from the code. We need to hash the strings to make them indistinguishable from bytecode. It's not really secure, but it's better than no security, and the tenacious hacker can already gain access to your Wi-Fi username and password through tools like SharkWire. So it's all about lowering the risk and risk management. We're going to write some MicroPython code to decode a string. We're also going to write some MicroPython code to encode a string. We're going to write some obfuscation code to make it harder to understand how the string is decoded. And then we're going to compile that MicroPython code into a library that can't easily be reverse engineered. And then we're going to upload that library to our device. So let's set up our tool chain. We're going to use a piece of software that's called MPY-cross, and it's a MicroPython cross compiler, and it works on Mac, Windows, Linux. It will take our MicroPython code and compile it into a library module that we can then give to others or upload to our device without giving away our source code. So first of all, we need to create a virtual environment in Python. We're then going to do a pip install MPY_cross. That will install a cross compiler. And then finally, we're going to compile our MicroPython library using the command python-m mpycross and then the file name. And that will produce an MPY file that we can upload to our device. So I'm going to quickly show you how I can set up a virtual environment. So here I am on the command line. I'm going to create a new directory first of all, and then I'm going to go into that directory. And then what I'm going to do now is I'm going to create the virtual environment within Python. And this command will enable us to create a new virtual environment that's called vienv. It just takes a couple of seconds for it to do that. So now to activate that environment, we type source. Now that we're activated and we can see in brackets there that we're in the virtual environment, we can now do the pip install MPY-cross, and this will install MPY-cross onto our machine. We don't have to worry about that pip message, it always says that. So let's now go back over to our Visual Studio code and we can create some code. Okay, so I've written a small program that's going to encode a string of text. So let's have a look at the code line by line. So we're going to import OS because we're going to do some file handling. We have a little convert program. It will convert a list into a string. We'll use this later. So basically it just creates a new variable, and for each character within the string, it will just add that character to the string. So, and then return the string. Next, we have the encode function. So it'll take some plain text and what we're calling a salt. This is some text that we're going to pick a letter from and we're going to add to each of the characters in our string to encode them. It's quite a crude method to encrypt them, slightly more sophisticated than a Caesar cipher, but it's not complex by any means. So we start out by just creating a variable that's called secure string. We then set a count to zero, and then for each character in the plain text, we're going to check what the ordinal character is, and that is a value for each character. So let's have a quick look and see how this works. So I've got the Python terminal open here. If I type in print ord and then the value of capital A, those people that know ASCII will know that this is 65. So there we go, 65. So that means for each letter of the alphabet, for any possible character, we can actually return what the value of that is. So what we're gonna do there is we're gonna say num equals the ordinal character value of character we're currently in, and then add to that the ordinal character value of our salt. and we're going to pick whichever letter. So if our salt was called salted, for example, we would start with the first character, which is a capital S. We'd get the ordinal value of that and add that to our character. And then we'd increment our count, which would then make it go to the next character. We add the ordinal character of the second character to our salt. We will get the letter A to add to that. And we're just going to do the maths like that. And that will just randomize. It will appear to randomize the letters for the person that's reading the encoded text. We'll do that for all the letters that are in the plain text. And what we've got round here is just a little wraparound function. So the characters can go up to 255 in ASCII. So if we have a character that's higher than that, because we've added two together, then we need to make that wrap around. So if the value is higher than 255, then we just take 205 from it, and that will give us a very low number. And we can do that the opposite way around. So if a number is less than zero, we can add 255 to it to get the original character back. So then we append each of these characters back to the string. And this CHR is the opposite of the ordinal character. So for any integer, it will tell you what the character of that is. So if we pass, let's go back down here. If we say print CHR and then brackets and then 65, it will give us that capital A back again. So that's a way of just changing characters between their ordinal value and then back again. And then we check to see if the count is less than the length of the salt minus one, because we start at zero because it's an index. Then we just add one to that count. And that just means that we can keep progressing through our salted characters each time we go through the loop. If we didn't do this and we just had one letter, it'd be very easy to spot that each character in the text that we're trying to encode has just been moved up by a number of values. So then we just return the secure string, and we're going to convert that from a list to a string, which is what that convert function does. I've then got a CSV function. So this will write out, given a file name, given a secure string, it will write this out to that file, and it'll just put a character in between each of the letters. And that just makes it easier to read back in later on. So that's our encode function. So our decode function works exactly the same. This also has the exact same convert function. It has a from CSV, so it will take a file name and it will read in the line into a variable that's called file text. And then we create a string array. We strip out any commas from there, and we can then go through each of the characters within that file text. And if the character is a comma or a speech marks, even though we haven't used these, it will strip those out. If it's not one of those characters, it'll append it to our string array. It'll then close the file and it'll convert that list back into a string. So now in our decode function, we can take the encoded text and the salt, and we'll always have to provide the salt. We can create a variable that's called plaintext, which is just an array. We can create our count, set that to zero, and then for each character in the encoded text, we will look at the ordinal value, we'll minus the ordinal value of the salt, and use the counter to move along each of the characters in our salt, and minusing them from the encrypted text. We then add that to our plain text, and then again, if there is the count is less than the length of salt, we plus the count, otherwise the count is zero. And then we return the plain text. So let's try this out and see if this actually works. So I've got a little program here. It's going to import encode and to CSV. It's going to import decode and from CSV. We're then just going to type in a username just to show how this will work. But this is the idea is that we would store the encrypted username and password in a file that if a person tried to access it, it would just look like random characters. And we would also store a salt. And they wouldn't understand from our library that the salt actually is used to encrypt and decrypt the files. So the username, this is a really big secret. The password is, this should be complex too. And then the salt, it's just like another secret. Storing secure username, the encoded username, and passing the salt. And we're going to pass in password into the encode function as well and store that in secure password. We're then going to print out what the secure username and password is. We're going to write them to two files, one that's called uname.csv and pname.csv. And then we're going to do the opposite. We're going to read those back in from those two files. We're going to decode them with the salt and store them in plain text. I'm going to store them in plain username and plain password. We're going to write those out to the screen, and hopefully it should be what we originally put in there. So let's give this a go. So let's just open up the console and see what happened. It says encrypted string, and there is lots of weird looking characters there. We couldn't possibly read that or understand what's going on. And it says it wrote out the CSV file uname.csv and pname.csv, and then it's going to read them back in, uname and pname. It's going to decrypt it using the salt. And there again, we've got now our username and our password. So let's have a look in those files and see what the contents look like. So if I click on uname.csv, it just looks like loads of weird characters. And I wouldn't be able to guess from that that says, this is a really big secret. There's no way to understand that from there. If we look at pname.csv, again, that looks like garbage. We can't really understand what that is. So any attacker that looked at those two files wouldn't be able to understand what's in them. However, if they opened up the source code, they could figure out exactly how all this is working. So this is where MPY-cross comes in. So what we're going to do now is we're going to make those encode and decode functions into MPY libraries that we can upload to our MicroPython device, and people will be able to open them but without being able to read the source code contents. So this is very simple to do. We're still in our virtual environment. So we type python-m because it's a module, and then we type MPY-cross, and then the name of the file that we want to become a library. So let's do encode first. And we've now got an encode MPY. So we click on that and try and open it up. It says it doesn't recognize the format. So we click on that, use our built-in function, and we can see there it's called encode.py. That's some text we can read. We can see there's convert to, encode to CSV, and if we scroll across there we can see some other bits and pieces, but we can't see how that actually works. We can just see whatever the plain text is that we had in our file, not how the functions actually work. So it has obfuscated and it has made them obscure. So let's do the same now with decode. So we've now got a decode to MPY. Again, let's open that up and have a quick look inside. And we can see there that there is some bytecode and there is some strings of text, but nothing that can actually help us understand how this will work. So let's upload the decode and encode MPY files to our MicroPython device, which is Raspberry Pi Pico. So we have to open it in this editor first before we can upload it. Let's do the same with the encode one. So let's try importing decode into our MicroPython. So if we do dir decode, we can see there the names of the classes. So let's do from decode, import decode, and from CSV. We can import the functions that we created just like we would with a regular library, but we can't see the contents of them easily with a text editor. So hopefully you can see that we can make it a bit more secure than just storing the Wi-Fi password and Wi-Fi username and anything else on the device. We do still need to store some kind of key, the salt key, but we can make that so that it's very difficult to read by putting it into a library function, which is then stored on the device. And if anybody tries to open the MPY file, they'll just see bytecode and some text, but they won't be able to distinguish the text from the bytecode because it looks very similar. So it's obscure. Unless they've got some very special tools for reverse engineering MPY files, this will make their job of trying to retrieve your Wi-Fi passwords and username very difficult from the device. So until we have a secure enclave on all our devices, this is probably one of the best ways forward. I'm interested to know what you think, and I hope you found this video useful, and I'll see you next time.